after that intro, I officially don't have to say anything. Because anything I say is going to just go downhill. Expectations are definitely at an all-time high. I think I'm right in thinking that this building was designed by Julia Morgan. And so I just want to pay tribute to that. She was the first female licensed architect in California and in the United States, I believe, and did most of the magnificent 1930s buildings of the Bay Area, and Hearst Castle, if you know Hearst Castle, which is crazy. But I just wanted to pay tribute that there has been some pioneering architects that have not only taken this stage, but have built it. So, I'm going to, I don't know if we need the lights down because our work is actually much more handsome than I am, and I do want to show it. But one of the things I want to start off is that we're not like you're, unlike Julia, we have something very different, which is that our budgets are extremely tight, our timelines are tight, and we can't make mistakes because when we're on the ground, we may be working in a community such as Ica, Peru, which is where this is, and 3 years after the earthquake, over 50% of the schools hadn't even been touched, like since the quake, the day of the quake. And so that's 50% of the kids don't have access to education. And this is a typical school, not right after the quake, but 3 years later. And a client came to us and said, look, we want to upgrade, repair, make it seismically sound, and a beautiful place for kids to be taught in, and you have 6 months, and this is the budget. So, you know, we have to take these kind of small projects, but with grand challenges. And in 6 months, they become something like this. And it's nothing that's going to win awards or going to be on the cover of magazines, but it kind of builds community, jobs, cohesion, resilience, dignity, and hope within a community. And it does that in a myriad of ways, not just the creation of the structure, but how we do it. And I'm going to talk a little bit about how we do that. So, very quickly, Architecture for Humanity is basically this ragtag bunch of architects, engineers, planners. They're kind of this small army, and they set upon themselves that they're going to dedicate their lives to bettering other communities. As Kirsten mentioned, we started off life providing professional design and construction services. Now, whilst we are a charitable organization and we're a nonprofit, we're not a do-gooder organization. Right? We're not out there to do good. We're actually, how do we provide professional expertise in a way that actually benefits and elevates the community? And so we've always been very forthright making sure that what we're delivering is not just buildings, but actually, you know, upgrading the construction quality, the standards, and the skills training within a community. Secondly, is that we build. There are a million innovative design solutions around the world. But unless you build them, it doesn't matter. And what we found is that when you walk into a community with a fantastic idea, you work with a community, you develop a solution, and then you don't have the capacity to implement that, you've not only elevated the expectations, but you've actually taken that expectation away. And it's actually worse than not even showing up. So when we make a commitment to a community, we have to make sure when we say we're going to build a school, that school gets built. And that's our social contract with the community. Additionally, we have to find new ways to discover the future, because we're not building for 2012, we're building for 2042. You know, most architecture should last 20, 30 years. And so we have to look at new ways. And this is just two projects we worked on last year. On one side, you have the Plastiki, which, hands up, who knows what the Plastiki is? It launched from here, actually launched from Sausalito, which is my hometown. And it's a 60-foot catamaran made out of 100% PET bottles, so your Coke bottles. And not only is the hull filled with the bottles, but actually the physical hull itself, the mast, and the living quarters is actually 100% plastic bottles that have been transformed into a rigid, seismically sound structural element. So for us, whilst we were interested in raising the awareness of the plastic gyre, we were more interested in how do we create off-grid living situations that could not just turn waste into material, but actually turn it into a material that would transform the low-income community. So on the other side of the spectrum, we were working in the Swat Valley of Pakistan, building self-help bamboo seismically sound permanent housing. And I'll show this project a little bit later, but The reason that it's the other end of the spectrum is the cost of a permanent house is $880. Now, the cost of a UN winterized tent is $1,250. So when we can build a permanent home where we're actually paying the locals to build it at half the cost of a UN tent that has to be shipped in and only lasts 6-9 months, then you're looking at kind of a development, a kind of progressing development a bit more than an emergency phase. So it's about like kind of creating social and economic change through smart development. And our architects are a little weird. Okay, there's no turtlenecks, there's no round rimmed glasses, they don't all wear black, they're slightly nuts, right? They're kind of, I'll give you an impression, he's two different design fellows. So on one side you've got Eric Cezal. His nickname is PhD MacGyver because he's got three master's degrees, construction management, architecture, material science. And, you know, he can blowtorch like nobody, right? You know, he's the sort of guy that, you know, he's got a pack of gum and some wire and he'll build a nurse's station. I'm not making this up, he really did. That is not his check-in luggage, that's his carry-on. And he got on American Airlines and didn't get fined. So if you can get on AA and not get fined for having that as your carry-on, you're gonna work for me, right? So we've got different criteria for, like, resumes. On the other side, you've got Pranima McCutcheon, who had spent 15 years working as a professional architect in Hawaii, and her origins are from Tamil Nadu in India. When the tsunami happened, she decided not only was she going to dedicate the next 3 years of her life in the villages to help rebuild, but she actually moved her entire family and her two young kids to come and live with her too. So she made more than just a commitment to her career, but her whole family. And right now, she's actually building, I think, the U.S. Embassy in Mongolia. So she decided to give up India and move to Mongolia and do some work there, which is kind of cool. So as noted, every single one of our architects works with a locally licensed professional. So we're not kind of overriding the local profession, but we're partnering with it. We're making sure that we have licensed architects and engineers who understand the social and cultural aspect of that. The other thing is that our architects, we call them design fellows, live in the villages that they build in. They live in the towns. They don't live in a hotel down the road. They actually rent a room in the place, and they can live there as long as 2.5 years whilst the building goes from design, development, construction. And so part of it is about living and listening to the community and not just implementing an idea. This is my favorite client, by the way, at the moment. He's a Buddhist monk, a surfer, and a carpenter in northern Japan. And we spent an hour looking at a potential site for a project we're building. And he couldn't stop. I mean, this is a guy who lived through the tsunami. He just loved that wave. And so he decided that's where we're going to put our thing, because he could surf in the morning. So that's what you learn. And so when we engage our communities, they become partners of that process. We understand, you know, sitting under the mango tree, that some of the best ideas develop right there and not in the halls of MIT or Berkeley. And we integrate kind of the social and cultural sustainability of that town. And so you'll see the young girl in the top corner. Every one of our school designs involves the kids who are going to be in that school in the design. Not because it's a cute thing to do, but in many of the communities, people don't leave. And when that girl becomes a mother, her kids are going to go to the school. And she's going to say, if you mess with that school, you're in big trouble because I built that school when I was your age. So it's generational sustainability. It's using storytelling as a mechanism for basically maintenance. You know, Cameron Sinclair, I'm Scottish. We're really, really cheap. So to like save money. And one of that is strong engagement of the community in that process. So these are kind of the basics. And then we actually pay the people to build the buildings. We don't believe in sweat equity. I mean, just imagine you live in systemic poverty, you've just gone through a conflict or an earthquake, you know, and then you get told, well, if you want a house, you have to work for free because we're here to help you. Like, the people need jobs. And so it's about how do we create jobs? And how do we start small businesses? So like many of our small businesses created through the construction of our projects end up as like Kiva grantees, right? You know, they end up, the folks that you know that get those microloans, like we help develop those businesses. So this is the only geeky slide I'm gonna show. And this is our basically sustainable reconstruction methodology, because it's not just about taking the funding and putting it between technical expertise and capital. But it's actually creating contracting procedures on the ground that enhance small business owners to hire locally and create jobs. It's basically an economic stimulus package, which Now I'm working within the man, maybe we could do that here. But you know, this is what we see in Haiti and Japan and other long-term development projects that we've been working on, is how do we create a sustainable, holistic rebuilding process? So as mentioned, we've been around 12 years. We've built over 2,000 structures in 44 countries, and we've helped around about 2 million people. On top of our, we have regional offices both here in San Francisco, we're on 4th and Folsom. We're in Port-au-Prince, we have another 30 people there. We are in Cape Town, and we're in Sendai. And then on top of that, we have chapters. Now, chapters are unique. What happened about 6 years ago is people would phone me and say, I live in Detroit, I want you to help rebuild Detroit. And what they didn't know is 6 years ago, it was just one laptop and my cell phone. Like, we were not a big organization. We just had a really slick website, right? We're like every .com in South Park, right? It's like, there's two overworked dudes, and like, they're stretched to the limit. Like, so you guys know them. And there I was kind of saying like, no, I can't rebuild Detroit. But I realized that's not the answer that they wanted. So I said, okay, well, why don't you, there's two things that I learned about architects and engineers, is they love to talk and they love to drink. So we started something called Drinking for Humanity. The first Tuesday of the month, you meet in a bar locally, and you discuss issues. And the first drink you have, so I'm British, so a gin and tonic costs about, you know, $6. I would put that money in the middle of the table, and then somebody would be the, you know, the treasurer, collect all that money, and by the end of the year, you've got enough money to actually build the thing you've been talking about for the last 12 months, right? And so, as you can tell, these chapters grew all over the United States, especially in college towns. But as they got older, they actually decided to do, they wanted to be called chapters, right? Because Drinking for Humanity sounds like they don't actually get stuff done. So then we formalized them, and now they're called chapters. So to give you a sense, and it's so great that you showed that video with two of your funders, because I love this project. This is in Chicago. Our Chicago chapter worked with an organization called Fresh Foods that had been mapping food deserts in a lot of the minority neighborhoods and underserved communities, which basically overlapped. And what they found is that people didn't have access to vegetables, right? They had a party store, which is what you get in Detroit, which is basically a liquor store with bread and some old apples, right? This is not how Americans eat. And so they said, okay, we're going through an economic crisis. You know, the city can't afford all these bus routes, so they're decommissioning all these buses in the city because we don't have the money to run them. So they convinced the city to donate 3 city buses. The chapter redesigned it into a mobile grocery store. This is a for-profit, not a non-profit, a for-profit entity that goes around and actually sells fresh vegetables. And they've been sold out every day for the last 6 months, right? So you're like, this is like taking two common problems. What do you do in a downsizing economy and a place with food deserts? So this is a typical project. So on the other side of the world, in China, the Shanghai chapter noticed that a lot of these big buildings being built in Shanghai and Beijing had migrant labor. And it was mainly actually couples, you know, it was the men and the women worked on the construction sites. And 9% of China is migratory labor. 9% of the entire country, not construction workers, the entire country actually go from rural communities to cities and they migrate where the work is. And what was happening is in the housing camps, the kids were left behind in the housing camps and didn't get any education. So the chapter worked with a group called Compassion for Migrant Children, put together these shipping containers and turned them into quick, down and dirty schools, and they had them up and operational in some of the construction housing camps. And this is the schools. And that's not a rendering, that actually is the school. So I'm going to look at 4 different projects that we're working on. One on sports for social change, because I want to talk about slow innovation. Like, we live in a town where everybody, it's like, fail fast, and if your project is longer than a year, then you've gone way too long. Right, I was just saying that I met 2 guys who had a .com, like had some app thing, and they were complaining that they were working for this company way too long. And I said, well, how long have you been there? And they're like, I've been there almost 7 months, and we haven't really like gone out of beta. And I'm like, seriously? So I wanted to talk about innovation doesn't mean that you're Zappos in a year. It means that like You know, it could take 10 years, and so this is a quick project about that. I'm going to talk about rebuilding in Haiti and Japan, open source architecture, which as of tonight is now world-changing, and then rethinking military sites, including repurposing Guantanamo Bay. So well, it's going to be a smorgasbord. Mm-hmm. So as I noted, innovation is a spark, right? We all have great ideas, and that is the innovation. But creativity is the journey that you stay on. You can do one small project that's meaningful, but what you do afterwards really matters. And that's what we learned, almost by mistake. So this is a story about an idea that we had to help a small village, and it's now turned into transforming the lives of about 750,000 kids. In 2002, Kate and I were working on a project to develop mobile health clinics to combat HIV/AIDS in Africa. We'd done a competition, we had some designers, we were working in a place called Somkele. And in talking to a number of the girls, we were astonished to find that the AIDS rate in this village was over 50% for girls between 15 and 24. And we didn't understand why. And then we started talking to one of the young nurses, and she said, it's really easy. We're on the trucking route between Durban and Johannesburg. And we're in the town where everyone refuels. So what's happening is all the truckers are coming in, they're refueling, and they're paying the girls 25 cents to have sex with them, and they're getting infected. So there was actually not a lack of doctors, it was a lack of advocacy about HIV/AIDS. And we realized that we couldn't go from home to home and just tell people. So we came up with this idea that there had never been a soccer team for women in this area, ever. And all the boys, when money came in for sports in this region, it went to the boys. So we said, okay, what if we started a soccer league? And we put up some signs on some trees, and within a week we had 600 girls sign up. So we were like, we're onto something. So we designed a field, and this is actually the first girls team working with the architect. We had hundreds of entries to design this thing. And we eventually, at the time, it cost us $30,000 to do this project, and we didn't have the money to do it. Right, this is pre-Facebook, this is pre-Kickstarter, this is like analog, right? This is like 2004, right? People actually paid AOL for access to the mail. I mean, this is how old it is. And so, you know, like I couldn't even ask money from my mom. And when you can't get money from your mom, you really know that funding's gonna be a difficult thing. So, really funny, we actually won an international design award for this competition, for this project, and they had no idea we hadn't built it yet. But the award was enough money to build the project. So like, we went to this award ceremony and said, thank you very much, we'll be building this now. So we built the project, and it was very simple. We had to cut back a lot. We ended up putting solar lighting, and we put in changing rooms, and we actually put in 50% of the funds went towards access to water. Because what we realized is the problem wasn't soccer, it was they needed access to water. It meant clean bathrooms, and it made an increase in the number of people in the school. So this helped about 800 kids. And then my cell phone rang. It rang twice. The first time it rang, there was this kind of very dry European who was calling from Zurich, and it was a small sports association called FIFA, which is government. And this Swiss gentleman, and I won't do a Sepp Blatter impression, said, you know, we've seen this amazing project in South Africa that's helping kids, helping young girls get access to health. We want to replicate this across the continent because we're going to do the World Cup in Africa, and you guys are the experts at doing this. Right? I'm still just me with one cell phone and a laptop, right? I actually was moonlighting at the time we were doing this. I was working at Gensler, which was an architecture firm in New York. And, you know, there's two things you do when someone calls you an expert. One is you act British and you say, no, we're not experts. This is a little project I'm doing and I'm going to go back. Or you say, absolutely, we are the world expert at doing this. And so that's what we said, and then they hired us. So a month later, we get a call from Beaverton, Oregon, from a sportswear company called Nike. And they said, we want to do sports for social change projects and build small youth facilities globally, and apparently you guys, the experts, are doing this. And I learned my lesson the first time, and we said yes. So it started this massive like transformation of our organization, where about 30% of our work is about implementing sports facilities for social change. This is just one of them. This is about how do we prevent violence by building urban acupuncture, small points that create social and economic changes in the community. And you know, typically in the donor community, you know, you would get a donor, let's say a musician, who's coming to Cape Town to do a big concert, and they want to do a give back, right? And what happens is that donor's only going to be there for a day. So they would build it right on the highway in the really bad part of town. So the owner could drive in, cut the ribbon, get back in the car and leave, right? That's not where you need the project. You need the project where the community wants it. And the community wanted us to track where the most violent areas were, and that's where we put our project. So mapping the areas that were most violent, we began to figure out where the acupuncture points should be. And this was it. And this is a tale of, like, if you want a big challenge, take a big problem. This traditionally in Kailisha was where women were raped, killed, and dumped for 20 years. Right? This was a park, and it was opposite a school for 1,200 kids. Right? And nobody was here at night, as you can probably guess. So that is the acupuncture point. That is what you take. You just own that place back. And so we started working with the community, doing an after-school program, healthcare, education, ICT, access to technology, a football field, and the kids are part of the design. We do full construction documents. We implement, it's all off-grid. We've been able to be outside of the United States, we're almost 100% off-grid technologies, because in the next 10 years, 2 billion people are gonna get electricity. And so if you really wanna make money, like, you know, don't do like, you know, ethanol in Iowa, go and do solar in Mozambique, right? That's where to make money. We had local artists, some muralists in it, small businesses involved, so that there's an economic and financial cycle within the building. And then these light towers, and this is where you could get clean drinking water. And what would happen is if there was something that happened at this facility, that would light up, and it would interconnect with the other acupuncture points to the police and the hospital. And as a result, there was a massive decrease in the crime, a huge decrease in murder, and the perceived safety of the space went up by 200%. And in urban planning, if you can get people to believe a place is safe, they bring their families, and then it's safe, right? It's never safe until people think it's safe. So the perception of safety is really important. So, you know, so far, 25,000 kids have used this facility so far since its opening. On the other side of the globe, we were working in an area that was looking at urban densification. So in the favelas of Brazil, what happens when you look at densification, you should look at it as crime. So you first get militia, like they're basically ex-cops who are on the take, and they would go around and get security money. They get pushed out by drug gangs, and then those drug gangs get taken out by weaponized drug gangs, which are the, you know, 13-year-olds with the AK-47s. And this was at the time when, like, the U.S. government was using the term preemptive strike, you know, for other purposes. But I was like, well, what if we did preemptive strike against social ills? What if rather than waiting 5 years for this place to become this gun-ridden drug zone, we actually put the community facilities in the heart of it and prevent it? So one of the things we did is we actually invited drug dealers on our design team because we needed to know how a drug operation would be set up and how to design against it. So, you know, what they told us is, like, we didn't give them the location, but they told us in this plot of land, what you would do is you would have two kids on the front corners, you would have your production facility along the back, you would drop off your money, you would drive around, pick up the drugs, and come back, because that was the safest place for the gang to operate. So we said, okay, well, that's the location we're going to own. So now we understand how you would set up a drug operation. We design against it, which is kind of a... they don't teach this in architecture school. also, you know, how do we communicate with the community? Everyday meetings with the community, making sure the designs were up to standard. But our architect, Daniel Feldman, in the corner, every Sunday he had a call-in radio show on a Samba, like, FM station. And you can either talk about architecture in the building or call in and ask for a song. So basically, he was a DJ for 6 months, but he was communicating with 100,000 people. So, and then we always would draw the plans at one-to-one scale on the actual site so people would see what was going on. So it's kind of a different way of working. I show these pictures because one of the neighbors asked me whether the contractor was ripping us off. And I said, what do you mean? He goes, you know, this is Brazil, you know. It's like corruption and stuff. And I think your contractor is taking money from you. And I said, why would you say that? He said, because your building isn't even straight. So apparently in the favelas they haven't heard of Zaha Hadid yet. So this is what it looks like 9 months later. We get it built and it's a place full of life. And I just want to mention this. So the other thing about architects is, and I was one, so I'm not picking on them, but I'm like, this is part of my soul. I am an architect, right? And if anybody got friends who are architects on Facebook? You can raise your hands, it's okay, don't be shy. They have the worst holiday photos in the world. And I can tell you why, because they get up at 4 a.m. before anyone wakes up to take pictures of empty buildings. And they call that architecture. They're like, I'm in Barcelona, I'm gonna get up. You know, it rained last night, so there'll be good reflection. And then there'll be like, you know, like some hipster coming back from some party and we'll have a great, like that's not architecture. Like this is architecture, right? Teenagers are hooking up, grandparents are with their grandkids, there's a stray dog in the building. Like, it's where life happens. Like, this is basically an empty room until we're here. And now we're here, it's architecture, right? So that's the humanity of architecture. It's like how people inhabit that space. And it's really important to us that people actually ruin our intent, right? They party on the roof of this building when there's a DJ in town. That's what the building's for. So we're really the backdrop of the humanity in which we're trying to support. So this has happened in Kenya, in Rwanda, with Hutu and Tutsi kids born after the genocide. This is a reconciliation project. This is actually going to be completed next month. In Mali, working with women's cooperatives. This is using football to bring together these. It's a women's soccer team, and each team has their own business. It's kind of cool. In Lesotho, tackling HIV/AIDS. Namibia, working with the Special Olympics. This was with Eunice Shriver, so this is in memory of that. In Mexico, this project is crazy. This group actually in teaching indigenous building technologies through the sports facility. So actually, it's basically a learning center and a building center that is kind of a mixture between protection of cultural heritage and sports. In Ghana, they were doing this project, and there's a 6-month delay on the project because they were going to wrap the facility in bamboo. But the community said, why are you paying for someone in Accra to bring bamboo to us? We could just grow it here. And so actually they started their small business and they grew their own bamboo. And so financially it was a down for us because we still got to pay for personnel, but for the community, now they're going to really own this building. So it's those sorts of trade-offs. In Kenya, where there had been a 3-year drought, we worked in a community to collect rainwater on this basketball court. Enough rainwater, by the way, architects are also bad engineers, so they way over-engineered this building. This was originally meant for enough water for 800 kids at the school. They collected enough water for the entire village in the first hour of rainfall. And now they can actually sell the water to the community and actually have you know, Poland Spring, like on tap. And then this one, which working with skateboard kids in Kabul, Afghanistan. I love this project. It's actually going to move to Kandahar. So Skatistan, 6 skater kids, Afghan kids, took skateboards, and they were kind of inspired by this guy who, and this is how these projects happen. This guy, this Aussie, he was a skater. He was dating this girl that he really liked, right? And so she ended up working in Afghanistan. And he was like, but I love you. So, you know, if you know anything about guys, like, we kind of don't think when it comes to that side of, like, you know, interaction. And so he just moved there, right? And he was like, I'm gonna be with you. And so he was like skating, and then he began teaching these kids how to skate locally. And then they realized something really remarkable. The US military and the Taliban weren't fighting on the streets, they were skating. So they began to take the city block by getting more kids skating and basically re-inhabiting parts of the neighborhood. So for me, that is like the best peace project ever, which is where kids are skating and stopping the war through basically a piece of wood and 4 wheels. So they started something called Skatistan. And it's a skateboard club, it's now 600 kids, and we helped build the first indoor sports arena in Afghanistan since the war that actually happens to be a skate park.
Ole ya khudam skate mezanam ya car me gani na khuda is skate park ka park me gani ya sozium me gani.
Okay, this is on YouTube. You have no time. I got the people have lives, they need to go home. So, in Guatemala, I also love this project very quickly. Anybody here works for the city of San Francisco? You can admit it if you do. They usually don't let them out until 9 or 10 o'clock. But basically, this in Guatemala City, they don't have any places for kids to play. I mean that. There's no places for kids to play. And as a result, city planners had been secretly working with street artists and activist architects to change the rule label. It's a street, and the day after, it's a sports facility. And they did 10 of these in 6 months, and they started owning Guatemala City. And suddenly, they'd been trying to have a conversation about parks for kids for 10 years. Now the whole city's talking about the fact what happened to these streets and why are they sports facilities. So now it's going to be 20 by the end of the year, and it's going to force Guatemala City to actually set aside parks for kids. So that, to me, you know, is really how you occupy a city. So in New York, very quickly, we're taking underneath the Manhattan Bridge and we're turning it into this. I have no time telling you this, but it's a completely nuts project, and Bloomberg's going to blow his lid. So in 7 years, we've done 23 countries, 40 centers, and about 750,000 kids. In Dhaka, we worked with a guy selling tea on the streets, and he was living in 18 inches between two buildings. He'd been living there with his family for the last 10 years, and our architect spent about $200 to build him a house, and it was just a place of security. 6 months later, he texted them and said, I love my house, I want to expand my business, and I want to go into the financial district, and I need a tea shop, a mobile tea shop. So they designed this for him. Aww. And they said to him, he said, I want to make sure that this thing has solar panels. And our architects were like, this is awesome. You want to tackle climate change, and you know, you're all about renewable energy generation. And he's like, I don't know what you're talking about, but I want to make sure that there's solar, because that will really help me, because I need the energy. And they said, oh yeah, we've got it totally sorted. We're going to have the solar panels connected to the hot water heater, and then by the time you get to the financial district, you'll have hot water. He's like, look, I'm 60 years old. I know how to make a cup of tea. That's the dumbest idea I've ever heard. What I want to do is, when people are queuing for their tea to be brewed, I want the solar panel connected to cell phone chargers, yeah, and that I can get some money for them waiting 5 minutes charging their cell phones, right? So innovation happens with your clients, not for your clients. And I just found out last week that he now has a popcorn machine because a cinema opened up, and so now he's doing popcorn, tea, coffee, and cell phone charging. We need that here, by the way. We worked in Gaza on a repair strategy, no time for that. I'm going to talk about Haiti. We were working in Haiti prior to the earthquake on small youth facilities, actually one of our clients prior to the quake. And what we found is that 50% of the schools in Haiti were uninhabitable after the quake. There's about 1 million people displaced right now. But what we did is, rather than going in and building small schools, we set up a rebuilding center. This is a one-stop shop where you get architects, engineers, urban planners, and financial support to help rebuild. We have a thing, it's very analog, don't go crazy people, but it's called a blackboard. And when your project goes on that blackboard, it doesn't come off until it's built, right? And you actually have to analog, you know, erase it. It's a swipe method using a brush system. And then the project is complete. And we're using this economic model that we've done. We have about 30 architects, and they're working on about 50 jobs right now throughout the country. They've been doing rebuilding manuals for local community members to make sure that people are upgrading their construction skills. We actually have a text line, 24-hour text line, if you want architect or engineering help. I don't know why you're building at 2 a.m., but you can be, and we will respond to you. On-site construction training, quality of materials, and then calling out other NGOs, which is, NGOs get money from you. You pay taxes, we give a few billion dollars away, and then that goes to NGOs, Beltway Boys, and they get their money and they rebuild. And what we found is that these temporary shelters, basically plastic tarp with a roof, people will spend somewhere between $250 to $12,000 for the same plastic tarp, depending on who they use and what they use. And so it's not that there's not innovative work, it's just that it's being choked by basically vested interests to spend your money, right? And it doesn't create jobs locally. Now, we can build a permanent house in Haiti for $7,000. So why are we building plastic tarps for $12,000? So part of that is there needs to be a homeless bond on international aid. So that's something that we do just as a kind of critical analysis. And then making sure that local Haitian architects actually have access to jobs, because international agencies come in and require them to have the latest version of AutoCAD. Like, are you using Revit? Are you using BIM? Are you making sure that you've got your... Like, if you're a Haitian architect, that's not going to work. So we make sure that Autodesk actually donates all of their software to us, and we take as much as we physically can. Believe me, we are like the robber barons of Sarah Fell. And we will take every copy that's offered, and we will distribute it globally. And then inspecting buildings, and then of course building jobs. I have no time to show this video, but we're hiring about 5,000 people to build our schools. This is also on the internet. So these are the schools. So we're gonna, this is a fast crowd. I gotta work fast. This is the Full Circle Fund. It's about to be disconnected very soon if I don't work. So we're building a lot of schools because 50% of our initial funding for Haiti came from high school children. So we did something called Students Rebuild, and Carl's here, he's one of the people who's been leading that effort. We have a funder that just wanted to inspire students to get involved. And what we did is we wrote curriculum so they could teach reconstruction in the schools. We connected through, there's a group called Kuriki that does that, and then with Global Nomads, which is also local, we did video conferencing between schools in New Orleans and schools in Port-au-Prince, and we allowed the schools to connect and talk to each other. And then they went out there and raised the money. Like, you know, they talked to Ellie Dubois in Port-au-Prince and said, what do you need? And they said, well, we need a bakery. I said, okay, we'll go out and raise the money. And so we raised 50% of our funding from those kids. And so we used that to actually, we asked them, what do you want us to do? And of course they said, let's build schools. And we've had some, as a result of it, we had some well-known people that have come in. But just two things to note. We have a thing called the no asshole rule, which is we don't work with them, we don't hire them, we don't take money from them. Politely, it's called the no ego, no logo rule, which is like, you know, we don't put any names on buildings, right? And if you're a big name, you don't get to name the school, you don't get to name the building. It is what it is, and the community names it. And so the other deal is if you're well-known, like you're in Hollywood, da 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 da. Right? If you just come out of a $20 million movie and you got paid $3 million to do it, don't do a telethon asking people to donate. You can donate, right? So a lot of the people we work with actually put their hand in their pocket before they go out and ask other people. So that's another rule that, like, if you're a well-known persona, you gotta put your hand in your pocket before you go out there and ask a bunch of high school kids to put their hands in their pockets. And that's meant that we work with really, really nice people, typically. And I'll actually be going to Haiti on Thursday and opening another school. We've got six more underway. This opened last week in Jacmel, and we've got one in Monwi opening next week. And then here in San Francisco, there was an architecture firm. I just want to tell this story very briefly. She's looking really mad. Look at 15 minutes. Yeah, 15. Oh, jeez. We've got to rebuild like Japan in 15 minutes. We've got to do the TED Prize. I can do that too. So. Bar Architects around the corner, and their staff wanted to help after the rebuilding of Haiti. And they realized that they had vacation time. And so they said, you know what we're gonna do, is we're gonna gang all of our vacation time in the same 2 weeks and leave. And the principal of the firm was like, what? Like, they were like, no, we're all going for 2 weeks. You imagine your office, just every staff member said, we're all taking our vacation these 2 weeks, let the clients know. And they were like, and so what we did is we worked with them and they said, okay, instead of doing that, it would actually be more beneficial that you spread your vacation time out over 6 months and that there's always an architect from your firm on the ground in Haiti working hand in hand with our architects, and they circle through, they cycle through, and all the CAD work can be insourced to San Francisco with the team that have been part of that loop. So as a result, they designed and built, you know, hand in hand with the community, a school complex which is just under construction this month, and by next year they would have completed it. So it's a new model of pro bono philanthropy. It's not just about giving money, it's about giving expertise, which I think is really exciting. There's two ways to get fired from my organization. By the way, I pay our architects for two reasons. We don't pay them well because we don't get a lot of donations. But, you know, part of that is we put them on contract. And they're on a three-way contract with us and the client. If they don't do something that the client wants, or they just neglect the project, they can be fired. Have you ever tried to fire a volunteer? Somebody who's giving free time to your organization, and you look them in the eye and say, even though you're giving us free time, you being here is detrimental to the mission of our organization. That is not a sentence you ever want to say. So when you're doing professional services, you put people on contract and they know it's a serious job. And so if you don't abide by the needs of the community, that's one way to get fired. But the other way is if you see something that endangers the livelihoods of a community and you don't act, you wait, you'll get fired. And this is a point case. It happens very rarely, but when it does, our staff always make the right decision. So I was in Port-au-Prince in the early days in the JP camp, which is Sean Penn's refugee camp. Sorry to call it that, but it is. It's Pétionville, and there's 60,000 people there. And Nicole, a nurse there, said, could you help me for a couple of hours deliver some babies? And, you know, what do you say? Like, sorry, I've got things to do. So like, before I know it, I'm in a pop tent that's about the size of the stage, and there's eight women in deck chairs. Like, no epidurals, right? It's like Apocalypse Now, right? This is a question just for the guys in the room. Have you seen a live birth? Have you seen a live birth? Okay, so for those who are the participants, that's one thing, but the viewer, I've seen a live birth over at CPMC. I've seen it. And even with an epidural, it's the scariest movie I ever watched in my entire life. It is like horrific. It's like I was like scared, concerned, freaked out, and I've just met these eight women and I haven't even shaken their hands. And I there's certain things that I just want to know your name before I catch your baby, right? Like that's part of the role of the human connection thing. But so I'm there for a while and I do what I can and I'm like all scrubbed up. And after a while I leave because I just can't handle it because I'm a wuss. But a couple of weeks later it started raining. And I didn't think about the tent. So I was like, what's happened to the women who are giving birth? Because births don't stop for tropical storms or hurricanes. Like, you're gonna give birth, you're gonna give birth. And sure enough, this is like the only photo you really wanna see of that pop tent. And our architect said, okay, let's go to work. And they worked with the Can Do Foundation and a couple of others, and they got some funding. And within 7 days, they built a women's clinic. All the labor was from the camps. They appealed and they said, look, if this was you or your wife or your daughter or your mother, would you let this happen? Of course, everyone said no, and so they helped build it. And so it was built, and when a hurricane did hit the camp and wiped out the staff quarters, all the staff ran into the clinic, because at 2 in the morning, someone shouted out, an architect designed the clinic, we should run in there. Which I don't think in the history of mankind, anybody can understand. Toilets, if you want to save the lives of 5 million people, design a toilet, right? If that's the only thing you learned tonight, design a toilet. Make money out of it, I don't care, but you could save 5 million lives by just designing a toilet. Okay, we're building a town in Haiti with President Carter and Habitat. It broke ground on November 4th, and they'll complete the housing project. When? Let's see, who knows? This is Santos. They've done 150 houses so far. They've got another 100 houses to go by the end of December. So they're going to 250 homes. But the thing that makes it really interesting is that we've embedded economic corridors and schools, and it's actually a holistic plan of growth and not just a future slum. So that's the problem in house development is people build basically lots of houses and they become future slums. The thing that makes it important is how do you create economic corridors and incentivize the job potential, and that's done by actually designing the town correctly. I have no time for this. In Christchurch, we're rebuilding a school in the downtown of the CBD, which is actually interlocked with all the businesses, and actually the curriculum is defined by the businesses and the students together. I have no time for that. Japan. So in Japan in March, we got asked to get involved. I'd been working in Japan for 7 years, but not in this capacity, and they asked if Architecture Humanity could be like one of the few, if not only, Western NGOs working on the ground. And we did that first by actually doing a ramen noodle shop. How long have I got?
You're good. Okay.
So, I'm really excited to show this stuff, I'm sorry. So, when we were in the shelters, the number one thing that people didn't want was a house. The number one thing they didn't want was money. What they wanted was a bowl of ramen noodles. It's the number one thing. So our interaction with the community was, how do we provide hot ramen noodles to the shelters? And so we took some old Toyota trucks, we redesigned them into ramen noodle shops, and that became our first project. And as a result, and this was a $700 project, and as a result, we were able to start a small business, a for-profit, to help deliver hot ramen noodles, and it was a local. And then from that, we ended up realizing that Japan is not a place that has a donor culture. In the north, they are freaking crazy, right? They're not your cool, hipster, Tokyo, like Japanese people. They're not your like fun, crazy party karaoke Osaka, you know, people. This is the North, right? And the North is like hardcore fishermen who, they would go further than anyone else. They would go into the most dangerous seas and they would get that $800,000 catch and that would be it for the year. They are tough as nails. They are not like, you know, cutesy, like, look at this animation. Like, they are just tough, right? So you can't go in there and be like, hey, look, we have a mascot. Would you like us to work with you? Like, they just want that. So what we had to provide was basically a carpenter, a local architect, and we now have an economic development official who works with us. So we created a team that was about social investment. It was, and in Japan, we're not a non-profit. We are a social enterprise because they actually trust us. So it's understanding the character of this. And just to let you know, this sign here, this was just a few weeks ago, this is a sign that you see all over the North. And I will give you the direct translation because I can swear in San Francisco. It says, fuck you, tsunami, we're coming back. Right? And to give you a sense, and Kate and I both worked in and around the World Trade Center during 9/11, and we had friends who were down there, and we were a part of the rebuilding of that. Actually, my client was in WTC1, and I worked with them for a year, so I understand the kind of zeitgeist of that first year in New York. And I can tell you the difference was remarkable, because on the 6-month anniversary, they invited me to come for the, you know, just the memorial, and every Japanese person in the North just stood on the water's edge, and they blared the tsunami siren for 2 minutes at the exact moment the tsunami hit, and everyone just stared at the sea silently. It was the most chilling moment I've had this year. Just like understanding, this was them saying like, you can't take us. And to understand that the tsunami was 92 feet high at 200 miles an hour. This was not a small wave. There was multiple waves, as you saw. So this is a very strong people, so we have to work very differently with them. So the first thing we did is we did actually kind of a beer garden and a community hall. We hired people from Fukushima who were carpenters and used traditional Edo carpentry so that we actually, you know, made sure they had jobs. And we created this sushi sake bar, which is actually next to 250 new temporary homes and is full every day, and that's the community center. From that, we actually did, you may not see it, but at the top, I don't think it's in here, at the top of that tree that's going through, we everything that we built was from reclaimed lumber and post-tsunami devastation. And so there's this idea of memory and ghosts within that. I have no time. But one of the fishermen, none of the fishermen had jobs, the tuna fishermen, because they lost their boats. And one of them created this beautiful sculpture out of his fishing stuff. And he used the old weaving. And they decided from that, why don't we actually weave hammocks? Because we're going to sit on our ass for the next year. And then they realized that's a social business. So they did a website for a hammock. They needed the heaviest person, which was me, so I'm the chief hammock tester. Within a month, they had 750 orders for these hammocks, and now 12 fishermen have full-time jobs for the rest of the year. So, you know, this is kind of social businesses coming out of the tsunami you never hear about. We're doing a sports facility that is an asparagus farm. So it's Asparagus United. Have no time for this, but I just love this model. This was on Monday. Again, we're actually using downed utility poles to create the surround around the football field, and then we're hiring the fishermen to create the netting that goes around it, so it's all local label, local sourced. This is a judo studio, no time for that. My favorite client in Japan, so this is Sato-san. I love Sato-san. So you gotta understand, it's always about the people, it's not about the project. Now, Sato-san was ridiculed for 20 years. Everyone made fun of him because he couldn't tie knots. And he's a fisherman. And he was the worst person in the entire bay at tying his boat up. And his boat would always like float out to sea. And they were like, Sato-san, can't you tie knots? You're a fisherman. Like, he was constantly ridiculed. Like, why can't you tie knots? You've been doing this for your whole life. So the tsunami happens. Guess what happens? Sato-san doesn't know how to tie knots. Everybody's boat got smashed to pieces. But his boat lifted and moved 2 kilometers inland and rested without any damage on the Japan railway lines. Not a single bit, and that boat right there is his boat. That's Sato-san's boat. So the biggest, like, Like, I don't know what the Japanese way of saying I told you so is, but it's in his eyebrows. Basically, he is the only fish. So we're actually doing an oyster bar and a banya for the fishermen, and he started his own fishermen's union with the surviving fishermen of the town. So, and this is a project that we're going to do. So I have no time to talk about that. This is a diversified funding strategy, how we work with individuals and family foundations and corporations, and understanding that corporations actually will say that they're going to give you money after the event, but they actually don't give it to you a year later. So you have to bridge that gap with families. So real seed funding and innovation happens not with corporations and institutions, but actually with family foundations and individuals. So to understand how the funding cycle works. So to give you an example, 50% of our stuff was funded by kids. We asked them if they could make a paper crane. They had to make 100,000 paper cranes in a month. And my funder, she lives in Seattle. Her son runs a book company called Amazon.com. And she said, I'll donate $2 for every paper crane made. And we'll give them a month. I said, okay. A month later, 4 million cranes showed up in their offices in Seattle. Jackie called me and said, can we make another deal on the whole $2 per crane thing? And so, of course, you know, it's Jackie and Mike are super sweet, so we kind of like made this deal, and they actually donated 400,000, and then we actually had an executive at Google chip in another 100K, and so it became a $500,000 pop. And then all the kids started donating as well. And then Vic Munez, who the movie Wasteland, he's an artist from Brazil, created this, and now there's a poster you can buy of it. This is just 100,000 of the cranes. On the other side of it, there's a Berkeley organization called PACT, and they called us and said, we want to do a partnership with you, because our other funding pool on individuals is the millennial generation, and they're not really interested in making paper cranes, or they don't want direct mail. They want something that's a little sassy. So we ended up doing something where we did a cheeky idea, which is basically underwear. And they've been doing this every season. We got, these were all professionals. This is a forestry expert. This is a sustainability policy expert. This guy has a web company and is single, by the way. It's part of the contract. We had a secret Facebook page where people would say that they were willing to be the model. And we ended up with a global photo shoot that happened in 8 cities around the world. And this guy, super awesome, Falling Whistles, he's preventing genocide in the Congo, also single. And as a result, we have this kind of line of underwear that's being sold completely online, using kind of compassionate consumerism. And I'm going to quick, this is Stanford MBA, if anybody knows anyone from Stanford MBA, they did it too. And I'm going to quickly show the video that was on the web. And they had the biggest sale on Monday that they've ever had with Cyber Monday. It's the PAC's biggest seller. So this is what they did on Monday. Focus in on innovation rather than wait 2 or 3 years for governmental funding. So this is the idea of like how do you fund fast? Do I have time to do open source?
Yeah.
You sure? We're gonna go over by 10 minutes.
Yeah.
Am I way over?
You're good.
Are you gonna give me that like San Francisco insult? Yeah. I'm like, no, you're totally fine. okay, so I'll do this very quickly because this is happening right now. So how do you scale change? This is the number one thing. This is the problem. This is what I loved about Jacqueline, that Acumen Fund. You should go and get Forbes next week. She's on the cover. Is one of the things we always talked about is like when you're successful as a nonprofit, people start wanting to throw a lot of money to scale whatever you do by duplication. Like, do that thing you did last year, but in 10 countries. And it, people end up being, their capacity gets strained so much the entire project collapses. So scaling by duplication doesn't work. But what does work is scaling by adaptation. How do you allow local organizations to adapt and develop and basically steal your ideas? And you do that through open source. And Creative Commons was the thing that was the linchpin for us. So last month we hit 7 billion people. So there's a lot of people out there that are looking for adequate shelter and dignified schools and health clinics. And I was very handsome back in 2005, and I was working on the ground in Sri Lanka, and I was completely naive, and this guy called Chris Anderson phoned me, and he said, you've won the Ted Prize. And I said, who's Ted? I had no idea. And he said, well, you know, it's a conference, and we give an award, and you get $100,000. I said, that's amazing. I take cash or check or whatever. And he said, you don't get to keep the money. I was like, what sort of screwed up prize is this? Like, is this like some derivatives prize? Is this like Fannie Mae is sponsoring the what is going on here? And he said, no, you don't understand. The prize is $100,000 is to jumpstart a wish, and you get to wish for anything you want in the world. And I was like, okay, you guys are nuts, but I'm gonna get 100K, so I'm gonna come, right? But I was like, because imagine giving me a wish, right? My first wish, by the way, was I want to improve the living standards of 5 billion people. And they said you had to dial that back. I'll give you a quick story of the TED. I mean, you're a TED community, but you know, I go there and I don't know anybody, and there's two guys talking, and one guy's chatting away, and I'm like, hi, I'm Cameron, I won the TED Prize. What do you do? And he looks at me kind of funny, and I was like, no, seriously, what do you do? And he's like, well, I co-founded Google. And I was like, oh, cool. And then the other guy, I was like, well, what do you do? And he's like, well, I started Amazon.com. And I was like, huh. And the only response I could have is, I search for stuff on Google and I buy stuff on Amazon. So we all have like a common bond. In which they looked at me as if I had just like run over their dog. Like I realized the people there could get stuff done, which was great because we said, okay, what if we could share solutions through an open source platform? What if we could take Creative Commons, which is being fantastic in the literature world and the science world, and put it on a building and actually open source innovation on physical space? And so we did that. This is one of the open source buildings. And anyone can duplicate and replicate that. And let's figure a way how to jumpstart innovation. So we started the Open Architecture Network. And as a result, you can not only project manage, you can actually search and find projects and share them, and basically use Creative Commons as a way to license them so they can be duplicated by others. Actually, all of our projects in our office, we've got 65 projects running concurrently right now in 22 countries, are all run from the Open Architecture Network as a project management system. And so right now there's about 7,000 projects, and they're from like mobile AIDS clinics in Nigeria, to the work in Mexico, to schools in Bangladesh, to housing on the Hopi and Navajo reservation, to a mobile medical clinic, which is a camel. Basically, you put the clinic on top of the camel, and then you put the solar panel on the camel, and then you put it on the ass, village, and it generates enough energy to run the clinic in the next village for the next week. So what's cool about that? It was designed by a 19-year-old art center student. So why does he have to wait till he's Frank Gehry's age to be discovered, right? So how do we make sure that these kind of young geniuses actually get the opportunity to see their idea realized? He decided that his summer vacation was to move to the Kenyan-Sudanese border and actually revise and build this by himself and work with the NGO, and now it's in operation. So the prize is completed, it's done. TED Prize is over, wish was granted. But something weird happened is we actually developed an iPad app. We got asked to be in a show in MoMA, and we said, how do we show 7,000 projects in MoMA? Like, it's ridiculous. We said, one thing that's really unique about the way we're super nerdy, I haven't told you, but we're really nerdy. and we love metrics. Like, we're like metrics nerds. And so we track beneficiaries, we track costing, we track, you know, timeline. We have, like, our whole team are super nerds. They dress cool. Look, they're in the front row. They all try and dress cool, but they're super nerdy. And the thing about it is, like, you know, how do you know what you funded actually got built, right? You have a slick website, but, like, how do you make sure that that actually got built? So we realized that by GPS tagging every single project we've done globally, you could actually create a mapping mechanism that could bring up live data of what the project is doing at the moment. So you can see where your dollars are being spent, who's getting it, the costs, cost overruns, things like that. So we did this as a $2 app. And we put it in MoMA, and they looked at us weird. But it suddenly realized that we could do crowd transparency. Like, forget crowd innovation. What if the world suddenly was the eyes on effective aid? And I say this because I ran into someone from Google, and they didn't understand what I was saying. And I just said, I want to do this GPS mapping project, and it's going to cost me this much money. What they didn't realize is the amount of money they were giving me to do the GPS mapping project was actually building 3 villages in Pakistan. And we actually, with that funding, we built those 3 villages. We GPS tagged every project up to the point where the family was in the home. And you can go on Google and on the app and actually dial down to that home and see the homeowner. And the next time that EarthSat goes over it, that house will appear. So you know that your $800 actually built a house. Why is this important? This group that we actually gave one of the grants to said, we actually haven't spent all the money, and is it okay that we actually build a women's cooperative? And if you're a traditional NGO, you say, no, I gave you that money for housing, you have to give me that money back. But having a fluid dynamic system, you realize that absolutely they can do that. So while this was going on, the USAID gave $250 million to Pakistan for the same project, and I decided to spend 2 days in USAID to find out what we did with the money. My friend from USAID is in the back smiling. So we went from, like, room to room, and we said, excuse me, you gave $250 million to Pakistan. Do you know where it is? And they said, no, it's not my department. And literally spent 2 days trying to track down where this money was. We actually found $10 million of it because the Department of Defense took out someone on the terrorist watch list who actually also happened to be a recipient of USAID funding. So, you know, what is the issue here? Is it turns out USAID does really great work. No one knows it. And so we're slashing our foreign assistance budget because nobody knows the great work we're doing, but you're hearing about that one story of the terrorist who actually got our money, right? You're not hearing about the thousands of schools that are actually being built in the name of our tax money. And so we need to change that. So the way I look at it is, I just love this, because people assume that the corruption is over there. It's in Pakistan, it's in Africa, it's in South America. But actually 30% of the funding doesn't even get into the country because the Beltway boys take it. So we have to kind of circumnavigate that, and you do that through technology. So we're kind of building a recipient-focused funding system that actually includes the recipient in a geo-based mobile reporting mechanism, take USAID on its head, actually give the recipient the ability to text whether actually that fund actually has been spent, and that allows a contractor to get paid, not the other way around, not pay the contractor and hope that it gets built. And then you do that through a vertical system of sustainability, and you do that with project monitoring and evaluation, and a lot of the things we have. But the one thing we didn't have was case studies and research. But I was writing for something called World Changing. Now, World Changing had a huge resource of sustainability and ideas and research, but it was going under. So I actually think there needs to be consolidation of failing nonprofits with good missions and good stock. So we, on the outside of this room, we merged with them, but internally we did a hostile takeover. And we just said, like, this is too good to die, right? And so we basically made a hostile bid to take the nonprofit, and we did. We merged it with the Open Architecture Network. And so the idea is not just about innovation and ideas anymore, it's about how do you understand impact? And how do you create applied innovation through monitoring sustainable impact? So. For me, the sustainability movement needs evolution and not revolution, and so we need to redefine and evaluate and learn. And we're going to do that with World Changing. And if you go on worldchanging.com tonight, the Open Architecture Network ceases to exist as of today, and it's now World Changing. and World Changing will be the brand that actually looks at not just ideas and innovation, but making sure we monitor and we have impactful results. We're also we have a competition on that site right now to reimagine decommissioned military facilities. I have no time for that, but just to let you know, the greenest prison in the world happens to be a place where the Bush administration spent $30 million on wind farms because the host country didn't want the facility. They also did water desalination because water was cut off to the facility. That place is known as Guantanamo Bay. And so Gitmo is the greenest prison in the world. So we had this funny situation where when Obama signed the closing of Guantanamo, we emailed his office and said, Architects for Humanity will be willing to take it. And as a joke, you know, it's kind of like, hey, you're not using this anymore, let us have it. And a couple of weeks later, we got an email from his department said, well, let's talk about this. And we had this like weird 6-month back and forth with the administration about what would it look like if Architects for Humanity took Guantanamo Bay, repurposed it, and gave it back to Cuba, and created basically sustainable diplomacy. Like, we actually use our money that was set aside to do sustainable reclamation, and then use it to create a space that's useful. So now we're actually doing a competition to repurpose any military facility in the world for public good. So if you know anybody who wants to kind of turn Gitmo into a place of social good, tell them to enter. Or if they would like to just do somewhere local, like the Nike bases in Marin, that's cool too. So that's me. Our mantra is very simple. Follow your heart, break the rules, especially on timing, and get it going. Thank you. So apparently I have like 10 to 12 minutes for Q&A, but what she means is we have like time for 3 questions.
Yes.
Hello?
Okay, anybody got a question? Number one, we're hiring, yes. Number two, in San Francisco, yes. Number three, I provide healthcare. Okay, got those for that. Those are kind of the 3 that I was asking.
That was awesome. Thank you. I was just curious if you provide internet access in these facilities.
That's a good question. So we did a project with the AMD's 50 by 15 initiative a couple of years ago about how to look at implementing smart technology within emerging countries. So basically internet access, but more than internet access. We looked at a whole range of projects, and we have done it. We built a facility in Nairobi, Kenya, which is a youth facility, but it's a technology resource center. And what we learned about that is a lot of the women in the slum couldn't use our computer training facility because they needed babysitting. These were women that were 14, 15, 16 years old. So through the design process, we actually realized that we had to do more than just internet access. We had to provide social services in order for people to gain the access to internet services. And so where it makes sense, we've always included it. The problem is making sure that it's, Hunter Lovins is, I have like crazy mad love for Hunter Lovins because she's like hardcore, if you've ever met her. She's and one of the things she says is the problem with the way that we deliver technology in the third world is we use broken technology that we were unwilling to use here, and we dump it there. So we shouldn't be doing, you know, 1997 Dell computers. We should be doing, you know, for a while I thought it was going to be whiskey. I was really getting excited. We actually need to have state-of-the-art, you know, zero-energy internet access that transforms the lives of communities and make it a for-profit business. Like, I actually, this is the one area that I think you could make a ton of money by giving access to the, you know, 5 billion people who need it, so.
I have a question.
You would probably get far more requests than you have people to facilitate.
Yeah.
How do you choose?
So the other thing I was going to, it sucks. That's the number one. So, but we have to make sure that there's 3 things lined up. the funding or the potential of funding in place, a strong community that actually believes in what we're doing. They're not just, you know, they actually have a specific need that we can appeal to, and then we have a strong design team. If we've got two of the three, it usually works out. You know, we can make it happen. There are certain projects we just love, we fall in love with, and we just can't give up, like anybody. And there's others that we just say we can't do. A lot of it has to do with relationships. It's like, you know, in the nonprofit world, not to rag on it, but it's like nonprofit people don't know how to date, right? When you go on a date and it goes badly, you're not gonna see that person again. But in the nonprofit world, if you have a bad initial relationship, in the back of your mind, like, but they're still funding, so maybe we should partner with them anyway. Like, who says that in a relationship? That's like the most unsustainable thing you can do. So the thing is, like, making sure that the relationship between, like, I was really surprised how strong and embedded our mission and Nike's were. Like, I was really surprised. It took me by surprise that they actually had a lot of strong beliefs in what we wanted to do, and what they wanted us to do is to be the pirates in the ship. Is to keep fighting the good fight and for them not to get fired for doing it. It's like, you do the crazy project in Afghanistan and then we can kind of like show that this is a feasible thing for us to get into. So, I mean, you know, it's making sure you have really great relationships. The other thing is understanding scale. So I was gonna put this in, I don't think this is gonna work anymore. Can you go for the one?
We're not in your slideshow,
but it's frozen. Okay, that's all right. So I do want to talk about funding, because as you scale, you get capacity issues. And at the moment, we are your kind of teenager that is awkward, and we're a $7 million organization. I started this organization 12 years ago with Kate with $700. And we were in a studio apartment, and everyone laughed at us. And it took us 6 years to get off the ground. And now we've got to a scale where we really can manage our work internationally. Everyone thinks we're a $20 or $30 million organization, but we're not. So we're in this weird, awkward phase where smaller donors who traditionally donated to us say, well, you guys are too big to receive my $20. And big foundations are saying, well, you're too small to really for us to give you that sort of capacity support. So we have to find a way to kind of like be awkward for a few years. And then when we scale, we can say yes to everybody. But at the moment, we have to really make sure that we don't say yes to the wrong group that causes the organization to implode. So it's the sustainability of our organization has to do with whether we say yes or no to the project, not whether we can make an impact, because we know we can do that. So, another question? There's one here. There's one here and there's one there. Well, that was.
I was just wondering, when you pick your different projects, assuming that we believe in this whole global warming thing, are any of these guys actually involved with how you take your new architecture projects to really consider that? I mean, are those issues when you come up with some of these?
Absolutely, and like some of our local chapter, like the DACA chapter, this is really at the height of their decision making. You know, when you look at Haiti, there's millions of dollars being spent in Cité Soleil. But Cité Soleil is right on the water, and in 20 years it's going to be underwater. So why are you spending billions of dollars like trying to make it a good place to live when it's not even going to be a place livable in 20 years? So, you know, climate change is definitely something, you know, part of world changing that we wanted to do is we wanted to have this kind of funny disclaimer that says, like, if you don't believe in global warming, get lost. Like, you know, we don't have to fight that battle anymore. We know it's real, so let's get on with making solutions. And I think, you know, part of that is communities are doggedly determined to stay in the places that their ancestors came from. And they, you know, even in the lower ninth, right, working in New Orleans, people were like, I ain't moving. I don't care. Try and get me out of here. And it's much harder to tell a woman in her 80s that she's got to move than to tell some kind of government official to change the zoning. Like, they're like, sure, yeah, we can change the zoning. But trying to get people to move, that's really tough. So, like, working on a grassroots level is really the way to do it. But I don't know if, like, the nonprofit world can really make it happen, like, on a community level. You can make it work on a policy level. Maybe not Canada, because they're kind of, like, pulling out of Kyoto. There was one here, and then, oh, there's one. I'm actually a much better person to talk to. These are really depressing topics. I'm just sorry.
It's not depressing. Okay. It's inspiring. My question is, you're bringing up all these amazing problem solving that you're doing, and all I can think of is that scene in Pulp Fiction where they're like, bring in the GIMP, and this guy comes in with fabulous ideas. And I'm curious, what's your brainstorming process? Who are you bringing in?
You think that's the way we brainstorm? I want to go to your Christmas party. It's like only in San Francisco would that be awesome. You know, it's not like, you know, chatting about cheeseburgers. It's that scene. Wow. You know, there's a couple of, I mean, the thing is we keep our design process local. So our designers in Haiti are in Haiti. They're working with a client every day. And, you know, it's localized. The solution's always localized, even though the problem is global. In San Francisco, we have to brainstorm a lot on how to make it happen. You know, I thought when you were going to go for that reference, you were going to say, do I have any GIMP projects? And I was like, yeah, I got a ton of those. Like, we got some real failed screw-the-pooch projects. And actually, in our next book, in Design Like a Give Down 2, which my co-founder should be finishing tonight. If she doesn't, she's in big trouble. She's not here, don't worry, she's finishing the book. We talk about our failures and projects we screwed up. Because I think it's important. It's one of the things is every project we have in the Open Architecture Network is there, including the failed projects. And I think that's the other thing is to make sure that we actually honor the failures. And that's what I love about San Francisco. Is like, if you drink an Epicenter, I drink an Epicenter coffee, it's like you can't actually get free Wi-Fi if you haven't worked for a failed startup. It's like the way they work. They're just like, oh, you know, if you come in, you're like, hey, I'm doing this. If you're like, oh, yeah, I work for that company, total failure, Groupon. And so, you know, I think actually there is a badge of honor in our failures, too. So I know that wasn't your answer, but I think in San Francisco, our brainstorming is really getting everybody in a room and just talking it through. And, you know, like, collaboration sometimes sucks because people like to talk a lot, especially me. Okay.
This is actually going to be our last question.
If you didn't know, this is going to be a double feature.
It seems like a lot of your projects have an economic component where you leave and folks that live there continue on and run a business through the space. Do you identify that economic opportunity in the design phase up front, or is that something that happens organically once you're on the ground?
It's a part of that design process. I mean, I think if Gandhi was born today, he wouldn't say, be the change you want to see in the world. He would say, be the bank. Because when you control the financing, you change lives. And, you know, we're actually doing partnerships with Grameen and a few others about how to make sure that these businesses are sustainable. In Haiti, one of our biggest projects right now that we're working on is economic corridors. And it's identifying the mom and pop shops that were the community centers. Rather than building a community center. So, you know, economic recovery is the key for sustainable growth. And so when people tell you that they're sustainable, ask them about the economic sustainability. Like, wow, you're LEED certified, that's awesome. But where's the business that's going to allow this building to survive 10 years? Like, I'm all for off the grid. I'm all for natural building. I love it. I'm a super nerd too. If you can build the whole thing out of bamboo, that's awesome. But where is the economic engine that will make this the best structure in 10 years' time? And so I think for us, we've learned it the hard way, is we've had some failures, and we've learned it because we've realized like we were missing a key component, and that was economic recovery. So, that's it. You guys need to drink now. You're really working.
Thank you, everyone. I'm going to say very few words. Thank you. It's a nice gift from Full Circle Fund to give you for being here. Thank you. I'm overwhelmed. I learned so much tonight. I think I'm still thinking about the drug dealers and kind of being a focus group on the soccer field, but it's amazing. So thank you very much for coming. Bridget and Molly, thank you for helping us coordinate this. And thank you, everyone. Actually, if you still have a few minutes and anyone that doesn't know about Full Circle Fund, please come to the back because we'll have a few people back there to talk. do about it. So thanks, everyone. Good night.